earnings as expected. What are you most worried about, actually, for the future?
I'm not worried about very much for the future, actually. We, you know, our business is very long term, and the long term trends for our business are very good. The world's getting older, global markets are homogenizing, and we've had Solvency II, Brexit thematic reviews, low interest rates, and many other exogenous factors. And we've delivered 10% growth in EPS, DPS, and a 20% growth in ROE for the last 10 years. So we're very relaxed about that.
I mean, I feel like every day there's one story or another about consolidation, about possible M&A in the insurance sector. I mean, where do you play into all of this? Do you want to go out and be an acquirer even more than you've done in the past, or do you feel vulnerable?
We don't feel vulnerable at all. I think our track record, you know, is very good, but we can't be complacent about it. That's why we've got a very focused strategy. If things come up which add value for our shareholders, then we'll have a look at them. But we're not being proactive or looking for huge transformational deals. We have a great strategy. We're executing it very well. We can keep on doing that. Our shareholders will continue to be happy.
But how many big insurers around the world do you see in 5-10 years? Is it impossible to answer, or is it going to be, you know, halved?
Well, I think every industry is going to change, and the opportunity to scale up using technology now is so much better than they've ever been. And so we will see new entrants in lots of different parts of our business. And so the competitors of 10 or 15 years ago, many of them don't exist. They've closed down or been consolidated out. And the big are going to get bigger, and but there will be lots of exciting new entrants. But lots of others are going to fall by the wayside and exit. And we're seeing lots of major exits in our business. And the landscape's changed dramatically, both here and in the United States. And indeed, it's changing rapidly in Asia.
Nigel Wilson, I can do this with you, with your eclectic wisdom, including the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in economics. I want to rip up the script and talk about one James Murdoch. We are seeing an absolutely original corporate exercise in Tesla. Now, you've got a guy on your board, Phil Broadley. I know he's trouble. You wake up every morning worried about what Phil Broadley's going to do with his work at AstraZeneca and the rest of it. It's a nightmare of a CEO. What is Mr. Musk going to do with his board, and what will James Murdoch do as a board member at Tesla after what we all witnessed over the last 48 hours?
It is amazing. You know, if I'd done that here in the UK,
you'd be gone.
I wouldn't be sitting on this program today having a pleasant discussion with you guys. And so it's interesting what you can get away in the corporate world in America. I think the regulators over here would be a little bit harsher on me, and I wouldn't be sitting here chatting to you.
What should board members do? I mean, seriously here, you've got a wonderful board at Legal & General. The stock has done better than good and all the rest of it. How should the board members respond to a New York Times Today or Bloomberg's wonderful work of an SEC look through, and also just the idea of where the money's going to come from for this transaction? This is bizarre, to say the least.
It is bizarre, to say the least. I mean, I don't know, you know, the specific dealings of the board there and how they deal with it, but I know our board with Mr. Broadley, Mr. Kingman, and the rest of my non-executive colleagues that certainly have had me in first thing this morning for a full explanation of why I would make that sort of comments. And so hopefully the boards will sit down and talk to what is a brilliant entrepreneur who's very frustrated with the markets. And we all get frustrated with the markets at certain times in our lives, but you can't take it out of them, because the only person who wins in the end is the market.
I'm going to try and save Nigel, Tom, for your very good questions. But at the same time, it goes back to the relationship that a chief executive should have with analysts and should have with shareholders, right? Do you ever feel like your shareholders are too short-termists?
I think there's a general view that shareholders are too short-termist, and that's why we've seen structural underinvestment. It's amazing that it's the companies that have been investing most that have been the most successful, and the biggest investors in the world are the US large technology companies, who've really driven the stock market in America, and have done a great job of responding to customer needs, serving that need, delivering great products, and creating huge sustainable advantages. In many ways, we all have to copy some of the best of what they've done, and not copy some of the worst of what they've done in terms of some of the issues that they have. But investing for growth is what Legal & General is about, and investing in technology to create better products and services for our customers, but also regenerating the macroeconomy in the UK, because it's too weak because of a lack of investment.
Yeah. Yeah, and we were talking, I think last time you were on, about the North-South divide, but overall, how do you invest in technology? So first of all, how much do you spend on algorithms as opposed to security and data protection?
No, we have a very serious cybersecurity program, which the board take active interest in. But we invest in startups, scale-ups. We invested in 200 startup businesses last year across the UK, invested in a large number of scale-up businesses where we're taking 20 to 40% ownership. And our top companies, all of our big growing companies, are also investing heavily in technology to lower costs and also better customer journeys. But as you say, we have a big regulatory and a big cyber investment program as well, because we have to do that because it's the right thing to do.
Where do you see the business going with rates higher? Is your actuarial assumption actually going to nudge up here with higher U.S. interest rates? Is the policy of Chairman Powell a change agent for long-term serious money?
I hope so. And certainly some of the things that we've been doing in the UK in terms of investing in housing, in urban generation, in building future cities. I'm certainly spending quite a bit of time in the north or outside of London, talking to Edinburgh, Glasgow, Newcastle, Leeds, Manchester, these really great cities, on what they can do to stimulate economic growth. And the US has some great examples of that. Austin, Denver, Seattle are all high growth, great technology-based cities. We have better universities than most of those towns and cities, and so we should be doing better than we really are, and we've got to invest more to grow. And the people in these cities, instead of waiting for the government, the central government, to help them, they've got to get on and help and self-determine themselves.
What's your calendar for Brexit this fall? I mean, we've been talking about Brexit across all of Bloomberg surveillance. This morning, we had one guest, Nigel, that made clear this is really the global issue. I can't imagine that with EM and all the rest that's going on. Brexit is a real determinant forward. How do you read that?
No, I think the government here are doing some good negotiation in terms of saying that there's a very high probability, 60% probability of no deal whatsoever. I'm sure privately that's not what they really think. But actually, it's just encouraging people to come up with a solution that's good for everyone. And if we truly believe in free trade, as lots of European businesses and politicians do, they should be getting on and getting the deal sorted out and move forward. I don't think in the short term it's going to make a huge amount of economic difference to Britain, but there could be a lot of bottlenecks if we haven't got the logistics sorted out in the latter half of 2019.
If people feel poorer, or if they have less spending power, they cut back on insurance or not?
No, I don't agree with they're going to get poorer type of argument.
No, but they could, right? I don't know. But
no, but I think what we're seeing is the UK creating record number of jobs. There's 32.5 million people, 75% labour partition, highest vacancy rates we've ever had, and so there's a different story out there of actually what's going on outside of London.
I know, Nigel, but then the BBC is telling me that I may not be able to get my medicine in time or my food. Part of it may be scaremongering, but actually, if you have a disorderly Brexit, we don't really know the effects, do we?
No, but I think most people work in the domestic economy and will continue to be served. A lot of trades, two-way trade in the same products through the same firms, and they've got to sort out their logistics around all of this. I mean, the idea that we won't have drugs available and food available is a nonsense, but actually it's something we may need a contingency plan for, and I'm sure the likes of AstraZeneca are holding a slightly higher amount of drugs in stock, but it's not wartime here we're talking about. We're talking about a relatively modest amount of products where there may be bottlenecks as a consequence of Brexit, and those are always the people who shout the loudest.
Tom, I'm just really worried about the imports of French biscuits. this is serious stuff in my household.
I'm going to bring you some back in a couple of weeks' time. Then.
There you go, just to make sure. What are the chances of a disorderly Brexit? And I don't know how you would qualify disorderly.
Yeah, I think
you're pretty optimistic about how it could go.
I mean, disorderly is, in a sense, is what happens at the respective ports, both exits and entries into the UK. It's not in terms of people's jobs, and it's not in terms of what they'll have available at a macro level in the supermarkets across Britain are, you know, their pensions not being paid, and lots of other things that questions have been asked of me today. That's not what's going to happen. And there's still a long way to go in terms of the negotiations, but the Prime Minister's got the bit between her teeth. She's in charge. She's got very supportive cabinet who are all agreeing on the course of action. It's laid out, it's transparent. The Europeans are responding. Sadly, we have commercial negotiations in public. You know, I have the privilege of having commercial negotiations in private, which, by the way, are much easier than public negotiations.